things. Some of the things may bother you. That's what the question is very important. The question is how I do it.
Okay.
I feel that politicians don't know anything. When I was a kid, I asked a politician who was running for governor of the state of Florida. I said, if you're elected, how would you prevent war? He says, I don't know. I said, if you're elected, how will you grow food to feed the world hungry? I don't know anything about that. I said, what the hell do you know? What do you know? And they don't know anything. They really don't. They said, there's always been war, there'll always be war. But they didn't come up with any answers. So what I set out to do to try to figure out what makes war, what makes different kinds of people behave differently. If you were brought up as a baby in France, you'd speak French, and you'd be a French girl. Do you understand that? If you're brought up in Germany, you'd speak with a German accent. In this kind of you came to this country. And there's no such thing as individuality, where you're brought up to believe in individuality. That people have certain natural behavior. There's no natural behavior. It's all artificial. All behavior and all values. It doesn't mean that what I'm saying is true, but I'm going to try to back it up. I'm going to try to back it up. Okay. First of all, I had an assistant to the dean at Princeton University, came to some of my sessions, and he said to me, you think very differently than the average person. Would you mind coming to Princeton and addressing the sociology department? I said, I wouldn't like that. I would rather speak to the whole university. And he says, how do you do that? Just tell them that Fresco says man can't think or reason, and they make everybody mad. They'll all want to go. And they all came, and we had to hold the meeting in the auditorium because the classroom on sociology was too small. Everybody believes that we have natural instincts. We don't have any natural instincts. There's no such thing as human nature, although everybody is told that there's human nature. The way men talk to women is women move differently than men. They use their hands differently. They say, oh, did I see a gorgeous hand? Women move more like that. And they pick that up from other women, from movies. There's nothing inborn. You do not inherit anything from your parents except the size of the ears, some of the facial features, but no values. Although your mother tells you, you go to church on Sunday, you do this, you do that, you do all that, and it looks like you inherited that from your mother. But you pick it up being around your mother. If you were grown up in China as a baby, you grown up in China as a baby, you'd speak Chinese, you'd walk with your hands in and you'd bow. You'd pick up all the stuff from the movies, television, Chinese television. You pick up facial expressions, and somebody says a member of their family is dying of cancer. You say, I'm so sorry to hear that. You don't even know the person. But you say that anyway. But you say things, and I'm trying to think of his name, Michelangelo, or didn't like normal people. He said they all said the same thing. Good morning, how are you? How's the family? Always said the same thing. And he said, my brother needs an operation. He doesn't have any money. Can you let him have $2,000? I said, no, I don't have it. Then why do you ask how we are? We say a lot of things to people, but we don't back it up. The language we speak was designed hundreds of years ago. And the people say, give me the good old days. They don't know what they're talking about. In Salem, Massachusetts, they used to burn women alive. That were called witches. And for every witch you found, you inherited their bank account and their lands. So everybody was looking for witches. And they found thousands of women, which they called witches, and they burned them alive. This is America. And then where did we get this land? We stole it from the Indians. They didn't say, come on over, build whatever you want to build. They fought back. They fought with bow and arrows. We fought with machine guns. And we won. And we pushed the Indians back. So, all nations are corrupt. All of them. There's not a decent nation anywhere on earth. They all use the same methods. They steal land from smaller groups of people. They attack their ships. And they attack the tribes, and they enslave people. All nations do the same thing. So, if a person comes from Germany, he says, Heil Hitler. He joins the army, because that's the only thing. Hitler burned all the books that criticized him. So when you're brought up in Germany, all you see is Heil Hitler. And so you do it. And none of us are free. They say, well, you live in a free country. You're as free as your purchasing power. If you don't have the money for an operation or surgery, you can't do it. You don't get operated on. Or you wait a long time till there's a vacancy. So you brought up to feel patriotic about this country. Einstein said that patriotism is a disease. He said he couldn't say that ordinarily as they shipped him back to Germany. He couldn't say what he really thought. So when you get to know how your country works, and the only way to get to know that is to read books that I recommend. And these books are written not by the enemies of America. They're written by...
William Perkins?
Yeah, I can find it.
Confessions of an Economic Hitman.
Yeah, I'm trying to get that book. I don't see it.
Yeah. No, I don't know. It's Smedley Butler. Roxanne would be interested to know what kind of country, what kind of system Jacques would endorse.
Well, I'm going to tell you in a little while. There's only one organization in all the civilized countries that doesn't use money. That's the public library. When you go to the public library, you can take out 6 books. If you want to take out more, you have to talk to the librarian. There's a book written by a colonel who was a colonel and the Marines. He was a good American. He wrote a book called War is a Racket. Try to get that book. That'll give you a picture of why we fight. We don't fight to bring democracy.
War is a Racket. Oh, Smedley Butler.
His name is Smedley Butler. The next book I want you to read, where is it?
Confessions
of an Economic Hitman. Confessions of an Economic Hitman.
By John Perkins.
Yes. Don't block out the lettering. I met Einstein when I was about 13 or 14. I asked him if he believed in God. He said, which one? There's so many different gods in the world. So he said he didn't believe in any of them. I said, do you believe in that certain things are a certain way
truth.
He says, like what? He wouldn't let me get away with words. So what do you mean by that? Do you believe in truth? I said. He said, well, what do you mean by truth? I said, well, that certain things are a certain way. He says, like what? He wouldn't let me get away with words. So I said, well, I said, this is smooth. He says, you really think so, don't you? I said, I have no doubt about it. He put it under a microscope and he blew it up and it was very rough. I said, is that what it's really like? He said, no, we can't see things as they really are. We can only see things as our receptors pick them up. You can't see the germs on this table. You can't see the radio waves moving through this room. We know there's radio waves moving through the room. So you're only as conscious as your receptors. So when a person says, I believe in higher consciousness, they don't know what they're talking about. There's no such thing as higher consciousness. There's millions of things you can't sense. Therefore, you can't become fully conscious, ever. When a person says, at least I'm conscious, are you conscious of the radio waves moving through here? No. A doctor came here and he said, we have eyes to see with, we have ears to hear with, we have a tongue to taste with, and a nose to smell with. I said, you really believe that, don't you? He says, I have no doubt about it. So I took him into a dark room and said, see, you have eyes to see with? He said, well, we have to turn the light on, and you need light to see. If there was no sun, you wouldn't be blind. You'd be walking with a stick. You understand? All right. So when they tell you in school, you have eyes to see with, you don't have eyes to see with. You have eyes and you see with them if there's light. But there's no light, you can't see. Bats can't see very well. Bats have very poor vision, but they generate sound, and the sound bounces back, and they can sense a table in front of them. They can avoid hitting a wire. Bats can do that, but they can't see. They can catch insects in the air. And they say that the purpose of the eyebrows is to catch a sweat and take it off to the side so it doesn't go in your eyes. Actually, what's the purpose of a beard? What's the purpose of coughing and sneezing? To infect other people? If you're going to find purpose in everything. We say there's no purpose to anything except knowledge. And you get knowledge, you're not born to be an inventor. They tell you that you're born to invent. That people are creative in music, art, symphonies. They say that Beethoven wrote the Fifth Symphony. And if Beethoven was brought by parachute as a baby, above the headhunters of the Amazon, and he was nurtured by the headhunters of the Amazon, he would never write those symphonies. He would be a headhunter. He asked him what he wanted, a straight gentleman that isn't warped. He would never write symphonic music unless he was exposed. So people are exposed to patriotism. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. The reason they get you to do that, in case of war, they can get you to join the army. We go to war because they have something we need. Oil or material needs. Cheap labor, factories, that's why we go to war. We can't communicate with people who speak a different language unless we learn their language. And their language is different. They say that man invented language to communicate. This is a lie. Man did not invent language. He had to have a language to invent language. He had to be able to think about words what they mean. So the language, as you learn, is an old language in this country. They learn superstition, religion, because people look at everything and say, where did all this come from? God made it. Somebody said that one day. And they believe in God. But they make God more like man. He gets angry and he creates floods. And he says to Noah, get your family on a boat, make a boat, take two kinds of every animal, but it doesn't tell you where he got the polar bear from. And who cleans the shit out of that boat. They don't tell you that. That's a dirty job. So the world that your education is not education. It's more propaganda. Now if I take this guy and I move him off, way off like that, and I let him go. If he doesn't fall, it's not magic that there's nothing underneath him. There's a heavy weight in the head. That's how come I can do this. There's no magic anywhere in the world. There's no evidence of any magic. There's no evidence of Jesus Christ, except people talk about him. Now, I tell you there's a God, and he made a man and a woman. And he's very all loving, he loves everybody. So he took a man and a woman, he made them out of mud. And he then made a snake, which according to the Bible walked upright. And the snake tempted Eve to eat of the fruit of knowledge. And when she did, he kicked them both out of heaven. Supposed to be all loving, all knowing. He would know that they'd eat that fruit. And when God kicked them out, he didn't tell them why he kicked them out. He said, because you disobeyed me. And he said to the snake, from now on, you're not going to walk upright. You're going to crawl on your belly. And it's easy for a snake to go through grass by zigzagging. But they tell you that the snake crawled on his belly because he tempted Eve. These are stupid stories. If you read the Bible and think about what you're reading, you'll see how stupid it is. Now God gave his only begotten Son to the world because he loved the people of the world, and they crucified him. And that's why Jesus said, Father, why hast thou forsaken me, before they crucified him? He thought God would intervene. And the Jews prayed like hell in the concentration camp, and they were burned alive. And the Jews prayed in the prisons that they were in. And prison is no answer to crime. Criminals are made by this culture, but they don't tell you how they're made. They say, well, I guess he's a bad character. He's got bad character, and he's not decent. They say, you should be decent. That means they make you responsible for your behavior. That doesn't fall upon the state. And they take the responsibility off the state and put it on you. You are made the way you are by the culture you live in. If you're brought up in France, you're taught France, vive la France. You're taught la tour de France, the Eiffel Tower. You point like that, like everybody else did. And if you're brought up in church, in Germany, you join the army because everybody says, Heil Hitler. Hitler burned all the books that contradicted his point of view. So all you saw was Heil Hitler. And the Germans thought they were God's chosen people. And the Jews thought they were the chosen people. There's no chosen people. These are just made up by man. When man says this is right, this is wrong, he doesn't know what the hell he's talking about. There's no right, no wrong. If you were brought up in the Arab world as a baby, be normal for your daddy to have four wives, if he can afford it. And if he beat your mother twice a day, that'd be normal to you. It'd be normal to see four wives among men that can afford it. So, if everybody in America had a pointed head and two horns and a nose a foot long, you'd have surgery done on your nose so you'd look like everybody else. There's no such thing as beauty. It's made up by man. If you're brought up in Africa, the people look beautiful to you. If you're brought up, if everybody had a nose 12 inches long, you'd have surgery done so you look like everybody else. And they be taught that that's a beautiful person. There's no such thing as beauty. This is made up by man. If you're brought up in Japan, the girls look beautiful to you. Unless you're told that there's a good-looking guy, there's a good-looking girl. You're told that. The guys get the other man, they cope with it, and they look at that girl, she's well stacked. And the guy looks, and that's where he gets the idea from. Don't get mad at the poor bastard, they can't help it. They're brought up that way. So all our actions are learned. Men say, look at that girl, she's shaped well. And men point that out to other men, and that's where they get it from. If men can't think or reason, this guy at Princeton University, he was head of the optics department. He said, I disagree with you. I believe man can think and reason. I said, give me one example of man thinking, anything. Anything you can think of. He says, there's thousands of examples. I says, I can't do anything with that. Give me one example. He said, well, there was a time when there was no camera, and a man invented the camera. I said, you don't know where the camera came from, do you? He said, well, no, I know that this guy made a camera years ago. Here's where it came from. In the Holy Land, they made houses out of mud, dome shape. And they put reinforcing in the mud. They didn't have glass windows, so they made a hole in the mud. The minute you made a hole with your finger in the mud, the outside world came through and projected the cows eating grass upside down on your wall. And he charged 2 pieces of silver to see the upside down world in his home. He didn't know what made it happen, but when you made that hole in the mud, that's what a box camera is. A little box with a little tiny hole in it. No lens. Like sleeping on the ground. So they made a mat, and if they got berry juice on them, it was very hard to clean. So they squeezed the berry juice and made patterns on the rug. And when they made patterns on the rug, something happened. When you skinned an animal and put the skin out in the sunlight, it shrunk. And they didn't like that one bit. So they... if I can find it.
You're talking about the patterns on the Indians, if a leaf falls on the berry juice.
Yes. They put an animal's skin out in the sun and it shrunk, and they didn't like that. So they cut strips of leather and they tied the skin so it wouldn't shrink too much. And when they cut these strips, the strip shrunk. They were cut like 14 inches long, and they shrunk, became short and fat. They didn't like that. So they tied it to a piece of wood. If the wood was too skinny, the leather shrunk and pulled the band of the wood. That's where the bow came from. From the bow and arrow. Man didn't say, gotta make a bow and arrow. Gotta make movies. Gotta make camera. Never, never worked that way. Man cannot think of anything new. Now I'm going to give you the proof of it. The Chinese, years ago, used to draw a picture of a woman, something like this. They took the scissors and cut her out. And they stood her on the table, like that. And they put a candle in front of her. If the candle flickered, the shadow of the woman danced. It's called the dancing girl. Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
If you put 3 candles, you have 3 shadows dancing. Then the Chinese invented paper. I don't know if you know that. And they wrote the number of the page in the corner. And if you went brr, past, brr, that number jumped all over the place. And that's where moving pictures came from. A man drew pictures on a paddle wheel, which he made. He made a paddle wheel, and he drew pictures on each spoke of a bird in flight. But he drew the wings here, there, and down below. And then when he would turn that wheel fast, the bird did this. And that was the first moving pictures. You understand? Then he drew water on each corner of the page. And when he went brrrr, fast, the water did that. I say in school that the Wright brothers made the first airplane.
Jack, want to finish that first?
No. The Wright brothers made the first airplane. They couldn't. They wouldn't know how big to make the wings. How big do you make the propeller? This big? You don't know. So you try different things. So the Wright brothers may have made contact with people who try to build flying machines. You say, what happened to your flying machine? I made the wings too small, and the plane wouldn't get off the ground. And the Wright brothers made a note of that. And this is where they got the idea of proportion. They couldn't come up with an airplane. They couldn't invent anything. Nobody invents anything. Now, a Frenchman saw this in the Chinese Museum, and he machined it out of brass. He did a very good job. He drew birds in their different positions, and when he turned it fast, the birds went like that. And the water he drew went like that. And when he put them in the box.
Sold it to Edison.
And he put them, and he put a slot there for a nickel. It's called a Nickelodeon. And you turn the crank, and I turned all the pictures around. And you saw moving pictures. That's where moving pictures came from. Leonardo da Vinci was not particularly different than any other people, but he didn't associate with normal people. He didn't like normal people, because they all said the same thing. Good morning, how are you? How's the family? Everybody says that, more or less, very similar. And he said, my brother needs $2,000 for an operation. He doesn't have the money. Can you let him have it? The guy said, no. I'm repeating myself, I know that. And what happened is, man never thought of anything new. He had to see some lightning hit sand and fused it in the glass. And when it had a slight curve to it, it made things look larger. So Galileo took two pieces of glass, put them in a tube, and made a telescope. That's where he got the idea. When lightning hit the sand. Now Beethoven was brought up in a musical environment. That's how he came up with a lot of music of his own. I don't want to see that again.
You got your pen?
So I wanted to change the Ku Klux Klan into thinking people. So I said, how are you going to do that? I said, I don't know. So I began to think of different things. My mother helped me. My mother was a racist. When I brought a Japanese kid home, she said, I don't want that fight around. I said, but you don't even know. I used logic and reason. Didn't work at all. He said, I still don't want him around. So I said to him, I'll see you later, Masako. I met him in California. We got along real well. He was third generation American. And so, what I did is I couldn't get to my mother. So a month later, I figured, I don't know what, if you can't get to your mother, you won't be able to change people. Mm-hmm. So I figured I've got to change my mind. So I told her a lie. So I was swimming in the East River. And I couldn't get ashore because there's a high wall. And I said, Masato worked on a boat. He threw a lifesaver at me. He saved my life, Mother. He said, oh my God, I didn't know he saved your life. I was very rude to him, wasn't I? She said, Stuart, please ask him to come back. I gotta beg forgiveness. I can't sleep at night. So I called Miss Settle and said, my mother believed the story I told her, which is a lie, that you saved my life. And she's willing to forgive herself if you come over to the house and have dinner with her. She wants to talk with him. So Masato came over and I told him that it was a lie that I told my mother. And my mother said, she talked to Masato. She said, he's a very nice boy. He's very bright. I said, how come you didn't give him a chance before? Because he was Oriental. His eyes were different. And I was brought up to believe that those Orientals are dumb. They don't understand things. So what I did with my mother is she talked to him. And when she talked, was talking to him, I walked out of the room. And I came back when my son went to the washroom. I said, Mother, what do you think now? He's a very smart boy. He's a very nice guy. He's third generation American. She didn't know that. And she said, he's very nice. And I said to her, Mother, a month later, she puts her arm around Masato and calls him son. She's completely cured. And I said to her, Mother, he never saved my life. She said, you little devil, I would have never opened the door. You understand? My mother was a racist. She was raised that way. I didn't know that. I never got mad at her because she was raised that way. If a man is raised in Italy, he says, tu sei italiano? You say, si, I'm Italian. That's a good. That's the way he's brought up. An Italian is brought up to appreciate Italians. A German is brought up to appreciate you. When you say the German people are God's chosen people, they like that. So all nations like to believe that they're here for purpose. A young girl came to one of my sessions. She said, I believe God put you here to make the world a peaceful place. And I said, you don't know what shapes behavior. They said, no. It's inborn. The male is born a certain way and he talks to female. So how do you know it's inborn? How do you know it isn't learned? How do you know a guy didn't say, look at that chick, she's well shaped? And men did that. They talked to other men. They said, look at that chick, she's well shaped. Men condition men to go for women. And they want to touch a woman's breast. All men are brought up that way in this country. So I say, I don't know whether they're brought up that way or whether they learn that and by their culture. So I found an island about 300 miles east of Tahiti, which is called Tuamotu. And when I got there, I brought mirrors and beads, which I was going to give to the natives. They hadn't been to school, hadn't been poisoned with our well or the French territorial ideas. So when I got there, they already opened my suitcase and they gave out my mirrors and beads to one another. And I never saw anything like that. I said, what's going on? They said, you have too many mirrors and beads. So they gave them to one another. But 3 days later, when the old folks pulled in a net full of fish, they threw fish at anyone standing there. Didn't say, you owe me $10, you owe me $7.50. They just gave it to you, because they had so many fish. And they had a lot of coconuts. They didn't care how many coconuts you took, because there was lots of coconuts. If you don't understand that, if there were orange trees growing all over the place, all over the United States, you can't sell oranges. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. Only if they're scarce. So, I don't know if you know this, but engineers design things to wear out and break down. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. Right. That's so that you'll buy more things. So, we don't want an abundance. We want scarcity.
No.
home and keep things scarce, and people treasure scarce things. So.
When you were on Tuamoto and they walked around nude?
Yeah, when I was on, when I got there, the little boys and little girls were swimming nude together. And the old folks wore no clothing. They were worn naked, completely naked. And I never saw a male on the island stare at a female body, only the eyes. They looked at the eyes, but they never looked at the female body. There were no peeping toms on the island. Can you understand that? Can you? There were no peeping toms because everybody was nude. And they knew what women looked like. If women and boys swam nude when they were very young in this country, there'd be no peeping toms. There'd be no guy, hey, look at that chick. They'd look in their eyes. So men are brought up to be what they are.
They had no pornography, you were saying?
They had no pornography. I went into all their huts. There was no picture of a nude woman on the wall because there was nothing new. And the missionaries came, and they said to the girls, you can't come to church without a cover, a t-shirt. And they gave out t-shirts, and the girls had no idea why they were wearing a t-shirt. So they cut two holes in the t-shirt so the breasts could hang out. And the minister didn't know what to do. Because it's not abnormal. If you're brought up nude with men nude, you don't want to see a girl do a striptease because it doesn't mean anything. In this country, it means something to men. So they go to bars and this girl does a striptease and that turns the man on. But they're turned on by the culture, not naturally. So I wanted to know just how the culture does that. So I went and I looked at these nude people and I watched the natives. They never stared at the body of a woman, always the eyes. And so.
They had no fetishes when they made love.
They made love in the open and they didn't touch the woman's breast. They had no need to. They just didn't touch any part of a woman. They put their hands on a woman's head. Said, we like you, and they stroked the whole woman. So years ago, I used to train police dogs to lead the blind. Now, a woman about 40 years old walked over, and she said, what a nice dog. She stroked the whole dog. She didn't stop at the balls. She just stroked the whole dog. And when she stroked the whole dog, she said, that was a nice dog. It helps the blind. I said, no, there's no such thing as a nice dog. That dog was trained to help the blind. I could have trained it to tear soldiers to pieces. Mm-hmm. Do you understand? Depends on the upbringing of the dog. The same with people. If people are mean, it's because they picked it up in their home or someplace around. They pick it up. The Italians are brought up to think Italian. They say, when they meet another person, they say, what nationality are you? Because I'm Italian. They say, that's good. Because they believe that Italians have certain characteristics. They don't have any characteristics, except that which they're brought up with. But there was a guy named Albert Fish. They believe he ate 45 children. And the public wanted to burn him alive. And Dr. Wortham said, don't burn him. I want to try to find out what made him that way. When he was 7 years old, he did certain things.
His mother came into the bedroom when he was about seven?
His mother came into his bedroom. He was. Children touch all parts of their body, but his mother came in when he was touching his private parts. And she said, you're going to burn in hell touching the part of your body. He scared the hell out of the kid. And the kid said, why am I going to burn in hell? Because you're not supposed to touch that till you get married. And she scared the kid. And the kid went to bed that night and he was screaming. And the mother came in the bedroom. He stuck needles into his genitals because he didn't want to go to hell. Can you understand that? He stuck needles into his genitals because he didn't want to go to hell. And by the time he was 18, he would take children into the woods, try to cut their genitals off to save them from hell. He was a nice guy, but they didn't look at him as a nice guy. Look at him as a troublemaker.
That's what a soldier is.
A soldier kills other people because he's cold and not good. He doesn't know anything about them. So if you were raised in Nazi Germany as a baby, you say, Hallelujah. If that's all you see. If you don't read other books. So when Americans are, I wanted to change people so that they learn to see things differently. So I made a bed for a pig. I raised a pig inside of a little dome. And I put a waste paper basket flush with the bottom. I put some crumpled paper nearby. And the pig knocked the paper into the basket. The minute the paper fell in the basket, it hit a micro switch, which a food dispenser dispensed a little bit of food for the pig. Not too much, but it took the pig 10 times before he realized that the paper in the basket gives him food. So the pig would pick up, if I put 3 dirty rags and put the waste basket, pulled it up and put it in the middle, he'd put them in the waste basket and wait near the food dispenser, which gave him food. But the pig didn't get the message until he did that 10 times, until he put the paper in the basket 10 times. Then all I did is put dirty rags in the pig pen and he put them in the waste paper basket. And I pulled the basket up and put it in the middle and says, put waste here. The pig couldn't read. And I put a suit on the pig and it said the Immaculate Pig. Mm-hmm. So I wanted the pig to change the dirty bed sheet that he was sleeping on. I put the bed on 2 rollers and I put a roller in the pig pen. If he happened to get up on it and turn it, it dispensed food. So he knew turning the roller gives him food. Never much, very little. So I connected the roller to the bedding and I put dirt on the bed. And when the pig came in, he turned the roller because then he went on a food dispenser, which I put in another room. I moved it away slowly till it was in another room. So he put all the stuff in the waste basket and he left for the other room. And I wanted the pig to take a shower. You can ask a pig to take a shower, and nothing happens. So I bent a rubber tube like this. I bent a rubber tube, and I put bamboo there. When the pig walked, it was a little lower than the pig. When the pig walked under it, it scratched his back, and he liked it so much. He turned around, he then went under it every time. Get his back scratched. And then I connected a switch to the bamboo, which turned on the shower. So I filmed that, and I ran that at a Klan meeting. I said, how come that pig is so smart? They said to me, I said, it isn't smart. I rewarded him for certain patterns of behavior. The guy said, I don't understand that. And this is the language they use. I said to Lou, a guy named Lou Murren, who owned a war surplus store, and I used to buy lenses from him. You might as well get that.
In a minute, yeah. Once you finish this, stay on it.
So I looked at the lenses and I said, I make optical devices of the lenses I buy. He said, can I see what you do? I said, all you have to do is give me a ring And if I'm not busy, you can come over and I'll show you around. And he came over and I showed him around. And he was so impressed. He said, will you come to a Klan meeting and talk and tell them what you think? Because you think so differently. I said, Lou, if I did that, they wouldn't listen to me. He said, I'm in charge. I'll get them to listen to you. I needed that. So I said to Lou, I'll come at your lesson to listen to me. And they listened to me. And I told them how I conditioned the pig, how I brought him the pig.
The picture in the post office?
Then they were laughing at Lou because...
Well, Lou said he had some special ability.
He had special ability. God gave him a special ability. He could look at a photograph of a person and tell me all about him from a photograph. I said, if you can do that, Lou, the hell with science. So he said, I can do it. So I got some pictures from the post office. And I projected them on the wall at a Klan meeting. And Lou said, he looks like a God-fearing man, a patriot, a war hero. He was projecting his own values into this character. And I said, is there anything else you want to do? He said, no, I just about described him. So I took that description and that picture and pulled the bottom of the picture out. It was wanted by the FBI for subversive action against the United States. And Lou says, I don't understand that. Because I know you don't understand. You were projecting your own values into that. So I said, and the Klan people were laughing at Lou for the first time. Because he always said things, never backed it up. And I said, I'm going to back it up. And I did back it up. And I showed him what I did. And Lou said, that's amazing. So I then played a record, which is a photograph record in the early days. I got it from the American Psychological Association. And the record is about a guy speaking about aviation with an Oxford accent. And Lou says, I can't see the guy. I imagine he's a skinny Englishman with thick eyeglasses. And the voice comes on, the voice ends in 10 minutes, and the image comes on. It's a black man raised in England, in Oxford, England. He says, how come that nigger speaks like a white man? And he speaks very well. Because he was raised in England. If a black man is raised in England or China, he speaks Chinese. If a black man is raised in France, he speaks French. There's no characteristics inherited. No Chinese baby was ever born speaking Chinese. They had to go to school to learn the language. No American baby who was ever born speaking English. They had to go to school to learn to talk. So we find out that the environment shapes behavior. So I asked some of my friends to bring their kids over to my lab, young kids, 4 years old to six. So they brought them over. And I asked the kids to draw pictures of a human being, and this is what they drew. Can everybody see this?
Mm-hmm.
Some of you still draw like Well, anyway, I asked the kids to take that to school and see what happened. They took it to school. And the teacher said, very nice. And she gave him crayon to color the buildings. And then the teacher started to hang him up. I said, don't hang him up, because you're going to arrest the kid at that stage of development. She said, I don't know what you're talking about. So I called a little girl over and made this drawing. I said, how does that guy get in that house? She said, I made the house too small for the man to be. She never did that again. And I said, does this guy eat anything? Looks like he never ate anything in his life. The little girl said, yes, I got an ad mass. And she added mass without shaving it. That's all she knew, that she had a mass. But she never made this drawing again. Do you understand? Don't let a kid get away with bad drawings of reality. Then I wondered if a caveman was sitting in a cave and he wanted to get up to the hill, to the top of the hill. If he stepped on a severe incline, he'd slip. If he stepped on a slight flat, he'd get up the hill. So he looked for flat areas in climbing the hill. And after he lived there 10 years, it made steps, stepping on the flat area. And when he moved to a new cave, he then cut steps. But he never came and said, I need steps to get up there. He never did that. He accidentally discovered it. So what I did to impress Lou is I took a cigarette and I cut it with a razor blade and I put a hairpin in it. And I used a blank gun and had my daughter, when she was 4 years old, she was standing and I shot the gun. It was a blank and she rolled her lips and the cigarette had a hairpin in it with blank tobacco all over the place. And Lou said, you're the best shot I ever saw, but I wouldn't do it with my own kid. I didn't do it with my own kid. I cut the cigarette with a razor blade. And my daughter just rolled her lips. And the hairpin blew tobacco all over. And he thought I was shooting a real bullet. And he said, you're the best shot I ever saw, but I wouldn't do that with my own kid. I didn't do that either. But he didn't know that. But that impressed him. He was a member of the Klan. And he said, will you come to the Klan and teach them how you use a gun? I said, yes, I will, if you get them to listen. So he got them to listen, and I taught them things. I said, if your son, Tolu, was raised in China, he speaks Chinese as a baby. He has to be raised as a baby. If he's raised in France, he speaks French. He's raised in Germany, he speaks German. And he cannot develop any language on his own. Now where did language come from? They tell us that people invented language to communicate. That's not true. That's what they tell you in school. One person once had, when a man first saw an elephant, he said, oh, oh, and got it, oh, oh, yeah, yeah, that's an uh-huh. That's where language came from. The sounds you made when you saw a strange animal, when you saw a tiger, you said, boop, 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 guys said, boop, boop, yeah, boop, I said, boop, boop. And as the years went on, you made different sounds when you saw different things. And that's where language came from. Man didn't say, gotta make a language to communicate. He gotta have a language to make a language. You can't make a language if you don't have a language. Anyway, I worked on people and showed them where language came from. I showed them where all ideas come from. Man wants a bird flying. And he said, you know, if I had wings and I moved them, and he made two wings, 3 feet long, and he put his arms in and beat on the air. He said, you know, I can fly. And he jumped off the roof of a little building. He said, it's not good enough. And he jumped off the Eiffel Tower, and he died. And his brother-in-law wrote, make wings larger next time. There's no other way to know. How do you know how big to make a propeller the first time? You don't know. You don't know how big to make wings. They have dihedral airplanes. That lowers the center of gravity. They learned all that later on. Man had to learn. So the Wright brothers never made the first airplane. They asked questions. They said, how come you made the first airplane? How did you know how big to make it one? I said, I didn't know how big. I made different sized wings and put them on. The wings were too small, the plane never got off the ground. If they were too big, the wings collapsed. So I had to use whatever worked. but I didn't know what size to make anything. You can't know. So when they say, the man that invented the telephone, nobody invented the telephone. They had a cardboard tube, they tied a rope to it, and they had another cardboard tube at the other end. And when you spoke, the string vibrated, and it vibrated like your voice. That was the first telephone. But it came about by accidentally connecting those things. Then there was another invention. They say Tesla invented the wireless. How can a man sit down and say, I gotta make a wireless? Where did he get the idea from? So here's how Tesla made the wireless. When you bought an electric wire, they wrapped it around a cardboard tube. Sometimes the wire was broken, so they connected a battery to the wire and ran a current through it. And if the current got through, the wire wasn't broken. So they took a coil of wire and they connected a battery to it. The battery was invented by the Arabs 300 years before Christ. Did you know that? They didn't make a battery for electrical purposes. They made a battery because they squeezed lemon juice into a big jar and they put two ladles in there. And the part of the metal flew across the acid and deposited on the other object. And that was the first battery. It's called electroplating. That's where that came from. And so all ideas were discovered. They were not invented. In other words, like I said before, when man invented lightning, when Benjamin Franklin saw lightning, if it hit sand, it converted it to glass. And he took that, if it had a slight bulge to it, and he looked in it, he made the glass look larger, made the sand look larger. He put two of them in a tube and made a telescope. But he did not invent lenses. They were made accidentally.
The wheel?
And then they say that man invented the wheel. And the invention of the wheel was the beginning of the technical age. Man didn't invent a wheel. A tree fell over on another tree. When you pull the top one, the bottom one rolled. If there was one stone in the way, it wouldn't roll. So they shaved the bark off the middle and made it thinner. And they put this on it, and they put weights on it, and they moved things. This was the beginning of the wheel. Man didn't say, I gotta make a wheel. He can't do things like that. Everything was discovered. But they say, Edison invented the electric light. How can Edison invent the electric light when there was no electric light? Here's how he did it. Edison didn't know whether copper wire or brass or iron would conduct electricity. So he ran electric current through pieces of brass, copper. And it offered so much resistance that it would glow red hot. The electricity flowing through the wire offered tremendous resistance, and it would glow red hot. He said, gee, he said, a source of light. That was his first experience. He put it on the desk, and it burned some papers, and that made him mad, put a glass over it. That was the first electric light. He did not sit down and say, gotta make electric light. Any more than Tesla said, gotta make a wireless. They notice certain phenomena, and when they notice that, they began to keep a record. Nobody ever invented anything. When a man picked up a javelin, when an animal came in and pushed it, if he broke it and it had a sharp edge, it went into the animal, so he made everything sharp. He didn't sharpen things before he saw the animal. So man learns from nature. He sees something and he extrapolates on it. So So man cannot think of new things. If he's raised in Germany, he thinks like a German. If he's raised in France, leave it on France. He's raised in Germany, Heil Hitler. And the German soldier is no different than any other soldier. Maybe a nice guy, family man, but he's brought up to believe in defending his country. All countries do that. They all bring up people to be loyal Americans. So in case of war, you get them all to join. And they don't want you to be different. They want you to be all alike. And that's why everybody is alike. They're made alike so you can control them easier. You understand? You control people if they're all alike. They're all different individuals. You can't control them. So they're not interested, although they say that they're interested in individuality. They can't be, because all the kids are given the same story about Columbus in 1492. And they're told about Salem, Massachusetts, but not clearly. They're told that women were burned as witches, but they didn't say how many. It's hundreds of thousands of women were burned as witches. Well, people say, give me the good old days. I don't know what they're talking about. There were never any good old days. There was slavery in America, and women were not allowed to vote in America. It's only maybe 40 or 45 years ago that women were given the right to vote. And if a woman become an engineer, they don't learn as much as a man. Who made that law? The man. And women are not brought up to be like men. They're brought up to be different. They're brought up to be ornamental. And men use them for striptease, for sex. But they're brought up differently. And men talk to women and they say, how about having sex? And women say, no, we're not married. Because they're told not to have sex till you get married. Then you have children, and you take care of the children, and you raise them. And women raise children, they cook food for children, pack their lunch, and they do a certain job. And women are brought up to do a certain job. They're not brought up as equal. Today they are. They study engineering, mechanics. Women study the same things men study. And they are just as good at an engineer as a male. Only they don't earn the same amount. They earn less because it's men making those decisions. And so, I got a list here. I asked a politician years ago, how will you prevent war? And I don't know, there's always been war, there'll always be war. I said, how can you grow food to feed the world hungry? So I don't know that that would be an agriculturist. I don't know that. I said, what the hell do you know? How can you make the world better if you don't know anything? He said, I don't know. So I asked a lot of politicians this question. How do you prevent war? They didn't know. Here's how you prevent war, how you make the world a better place. And it's very different than the way you were brought up. That's why it's hard to get these ideas across. I said there's a heavy weight in his hand. That's why I can do that. The rest of this guy is styrofoam, very lightweight foam in here, which has a heavy weight, like a half a ball, in his head. That's why I can do that. See, there's nothing underneath. There's no magic. There's trickery, always. Now to a magnetic field, this table doesn't exist. See the magnet underneath? If I take that away, and I... This table doesn't exist to a magnet. It's 3/4 inch plywood, but the magnetic field went right through it, I wanted to stand up, I turned the magnet and I moved it. See, a human being doesn't exist to a magnetic field. Did you see that? I don't know why. I have to break it in half. And if I turn one end toward the magnet, it can't be pushed together. See? I'm just turning this one, and it affects the other one. And a magnetic, and this is titanium. Nickel and titanium. 50% nickel and 50% titanium. This wire is made into a spring by wrapping it around the core and holding it in place. But if I try to destroy that memory by pulling on it like that, I'm trying to destroy the memory by squeezing it. I'm twisting it and bending it so there's nothing like it was. It's very different. And I can't destroy the memory. Once it's made, turn it off. So if you spell out Jesus Christ with a wire and then twist it and bend it and put it on the table and put a heater on the table and heat it like a hairdryer and you work the switch in the back, you go like that. And the wire goes into the name Jesus Christ. You can build a following. Hey, there's no magic anywhere.
How would you use this? In the future?
There's one building more than that.
Mm-hmm.
30 years from now, they'll make a building like this. It's a normal building. Only the bending metal is right in the middle, right where the joints are. And you make it with the same bend as that. And then you fold it into, and you ship 10,000 houses to China. And when it gets there, you run heat through it. And it bubbles up. And you straighten it out. It becomes a building. The furniture in the same way. You shape the furniture. And then you put heat in there, and the furniture becomes rocking chairs or whatever you got. 20 years from now, all buildings will be using memory panels. There'll be nobody working at anything. Machines will write music, poetry, and do artwork. But the machine, there's one thing the machine will not do, and that's feel. Machines do not feel. If you use a very good lubricating oil in the machine, it doesn't say thank you very much. I appreciate that. It has no sense of values. If you drive a Mercedes, the machine doesn't look at you and say, I wish I had your car. The machine doesn't think about things. And that's where machines differ. They tell you, that the machine's going to take over in the future. They'll never take over because they don't envy you. machines don't envy the hat you're wearing and say, I'd like that hat. They have no such feelings. So since machines don't have feelings, they will never take over. They don't envy you, they will never take over. And they will say, I wish I had the house you live in. No machine ever does that. They do what they're designed to do. They carry out that function. Machine does nothing but the performance it was designed to do. It never says, gee, I wish I had a chair like the one you're sitting in. Machines don't think that way. So you don't need to worry about machines taking over.
What go over emotions in the future?
Will that be one?
Emotions in the future?
Yes, but emotions in the future will be different than they are today. Like I saw two planes hit in midair, and they locked together, and they were falling. And there were a lot of people saying, gee, I hope they bail out. And that's emotions. I hope they do something about it. And they kept. And I ran into the hangar, put a fire extinguisher in a Jeep, and took the Jeep out, and I landed in a place where the plane fell, and I put out the fire right away. That's emotions converted to an action pattern. If I have three children in the back of my car, and the car turns over, and I can't open the door, and the gasoline is moving toward the engine, so, oh my God, the kids are going to get burned. But if I break the window with a log or a stone and take the children out, that's emotions converting to an action pattern. So in the future, there'll be very, very, very little emotions, more of an action pattern. Do you understand what I'm saying? They say, gee, I hope they bail out. You'll do something about it, whatever you can do. So Roxanne's going to take you on a tour and show you what we do here, the kind of work we do here. And we try to determine what the future should be. That first picture of a city around the city. See that picture? That's what the city will look like in the future. So follow Roxanne and do a show you about it. And when you come back, it means all kinds of questions. Even contradict everything else.
And you put in hundreds of palm trees and flower trees and fruit trees. We tried to make it look like a tropical island. But this is all, we dug all the water where there was no water, but the duckweed comes on it and drives you crazy. But we don't want to poison it and turn the duckweed. So
you had tomatoes though?
No, no tomatoes. We have no time for that. With our money, we bought editing systems. You know, a lot of people say, well, you still live on the grid, but with our money, we had no outside funding. We held outside jobs, and it was just me and Jack building this. I did all the cement work. And so with our funds, we, you know, solar and things like that, when we looked into them, were very expensive. So we bought editing equipment and cameras, because we wanted to get these ideas out to the public in video.
And then it's just duplicated all around. These are about as hurricane-proof as you'll get. It's built like a ferro cement boat, which is many layers of steel and many layers of concrete. And even if a tree hit it, it wouldn't damage it. It might hit some of the plastic, you know, of the windows. So you don't need to put poison bags over it and spray it with poison, I mean a bag over it and spray it with poisons, because no termites would eat concrete. Concrete gets stronger with age. It's, as I said, it's hurricane proof, it's fireproof. And the environmentalists generally don't want to cut down the forest, but they live in wooden houses. You know, they don't come up with viable alternatives. So I did this by mixing it in a wheelbarrow, because we couldn't afford a mold, but this could be made with a mold, and it could be pulled off, and you could lay hundreds of, like laying eggs by the hundreds a day. And you could have furniture built in, which makes it stronger. So, and when we first made this building, if you need to use a bathroom, it's behind the blue door there, but we just had a bed that pulled down. And at one time, after the mortgage crisis, Jacques taught me, speaking of you don't have to have talent, Jacques taught me technical illustration. He taught me the laws behind art, which you do not learn in art school. And then he taught me how to apply that to fine arts. So when we had to do the buildings, for the dome, when we had to get the zone, get them zoned, the architect could not draw the dome or the cutaways of the dome. So I had to do all the technical drawings of the dome, give them to the architect. They did all the math and the engineering. We brought them to the zoning board to get them permitted. And we did that with the first two buildings. We did two buildings, and I said, Chuck, what are we going to do with two buildings? Now we have 10 and we don't have enough. But so, after the first two buildings we brought up there, everybody came. Teachers came, cops came, the zoning board came to look at it as we were building it. And then I did all the blueprints again for the next three buildings, and I didn't even have to open them up. The zoning board said, look, you overbuild, we're here to help people, just do what you want, which is unheard of. But they were really nice. And so we did. We did what we wanted. We built 10 buildings. And then after I lost my job with the mortgage crisis, I did architectural renderings and models after learning Jacques' models, which were really interesting in his renderings. So when the mortgage crisis hit, I lost my work and we put this up for sale. And when we put it up for sale, we didn't have any permits on the building, and all the people weren't there anymore at the zoning board, so we had to go back and get permits. And they looked at this building and they said, oh, this is too small for a house, you'll have to tear it down. And they said, oh, just add to it. So we enclosed our hallway and we added a bedroom, and then they came back and they permitted it. But, so that's how it kind of grew. We haven't finished this, we were going to put the pictures up and put the bookcases.
Yeah, that's
right. Oh, the big man. Yeah, oh,
These models were done many, many years ago before computer animation. Chad, when we first moved here like 35 years ago, Chad wanted to show what the future would be like. So this is waterways throughout the United States or places like Africa. And then you bring this in it, which is evaporative condensation to get clean drinking water. You'd make, I'm gonna go real fast, buildings and dry dock just the way you'd make boats. And then you'd ship it on water, because this is the least expensive way, not in money, but resources, to ship bulk freight. And with 1 pound of pressure, you could move this up just slightly and move it over. These are research centers. This is lasers instead of Reagan's lasers weapons. You would, I didn't even show you on the animations, but you could automatically make canals throughout the United States. They talk about global change, you know, climate change, and the water's rising, but they have no solution. Jack has a solution to make automatic canal diggers, and you bring, we calculated, you bring the rising seawaters into below sea level deserts, and you, yes, just straight across where people are not living, and we calculated we have twice as much area to bring the rising water level at the worst conditions. So
and you can desalinate along the way.
You can desalinate or you can use this for recreation, irrigation, so there's no more floods and droughts. So the water's dying. And this would automatically, this would make this into obsidian. It would be lasers as well, make it very hard. These are some of Jack's aircraft when he was younger. He started with aircraft. This is a helicopter with the jets are on the outside, the middle stays stationary. This is all dead weight where you sit, the lift is in the wings. So Jack was a huge proponent of the flying wing. You just put people in a wing, the whole surface is lift, and there's a flying wing. They're beginning to do those now. Jack does not believe in going into outer space, that we have to learn how to live together on Earth first and then go into outer space as a joint venture. Otherwise, we always went into outer space with the military. I'm sure as hell there's probably nuclear weapons going around out there. So this is, he would put safety devices out there before he'd send anybody to the moon, and this would open up and these would be supplies. Oops. This is the art center they did an animation of. This was solar. This is a dome. The interesting thing about the dome, too, is it uses the least amount of material to cover the most space. And there's no structure under there. Once you put the skin on, you don't have to have walls for structure. It's self-supporting. It's another reason why he likes domes. This is the double dome, which we have, if you want to see it, if you have time to see it. And this is a tri-dome that always reminds me of Jacques saying in the future, people will probably be bisexual, they won't have any biases, or trisexual, where they try anything. You know, this is some of the structure inside the dome, but heavy tubes too. Jacques always thought we would be going to war over water. And he would always say, build the solution into the structure or the system that you're doing. And he did that, this is like 70, 80 years old, but we just did the models 40 years ago. There'd be a slot right here. You use the least amount of water to cut the soap off your hand. You'd store it in the shower wall, and then you'd flush and you'd clean the toilet at the same time. And you build maybe 25 different designs and you plug it in, and you do away with a lot of labor. This is a kitchen. He did the same kind of thing. He doesn't believe in doing kitchens in any homes, though. But this is a refrigerator that's round, so it's a lazy Susan. You can get to anything on the shelf. There'd be doors on each shelf, so you don't waste the cool. And then this would come down. But, you know, and then you automatically plug it in. But none of his houses are designed with kitchens. This is just to show that an airplane or any inventions are sequentially developed. But they called the Wright brothers the father of flight, but there's many people that died before they flew. So in the future, there'd be no Nobel Prize winners, there'd be no prizes for anybody, because anybody studying, say, cancer for 5 years, and they don't come up with any answers, and they write a book, you might read their book, and you don't try that, you try something else, and you might get some results, and they call you the father of cancer. You're not the father of anything, because so many people they would honor anybody working on the systems, not just somebody who comes up with something. Because a lot of people died before the Wright brothers could get them to that point. Jack did hundreds and hundreds of aircraft design. This is what I think is interesting. So in the future, you'd be thinking like this. You would look at everything, all the designs, and rethink everything that we have today to make it lighter, efficient, better materials. This is the passenger section. You'd land on the rooftop. The passenger section would go down. Another one would come in, plug into here, and take off. You don't need to wait for every person to get off. Clean the airplane and every person to get back on. The working section of the airplane doesn't need any rest. So you redesign everything. That's how you enable people. That's how you enable people to have a high standard of living. Everybody. This is an automobile. Jack does not believe in automobiles, but he designed an automobile too. He had many, many inventions that he did. And just because they say that competition creates innovation, it really does not. And the money system creates innovation, it doesn't. You have to have a lot of money to invent, you have to have a lot of money for a lab, you have to have a lot of money to protect yourself for lawyers, and then patents, and to be able to mass produce. And then people are always just stealing what you have, and you have to have lawyers to protect yourself. Anyway, and then for every invention that makes it, there are really literally hundreds that go down in smoke and become bitter. Jacques never became bitter because he had a really warm childhood when he grew up. So it set him kind of on the right path. But this is a car where the bumper's all around the car because you don't just hit in the front and the back. And also the wheel would be on the front, act as a bumper. He was the first one to do the airbag too, but his airbag was a membrane all around the inside of the car. Again, you don't hit in the front and the back. And an automobile designer looked at Fresco's designs and said, Fresco, you have no inhibition, do you? Because cars today have these little bumps and these little curves. This is the most aerodynamic shape to conserve energy when you're in transportation. Anyway, he did this car a couple of times, but it went down in smoke because of marketing. These are domes. The bottom would be transparent. You don't have to live in the city. This is the city, but it's just conceptual, where you design 1/8 of it and you duplicate it. You don't waste architectural time and energy and abilities. And, you know, you can't maintain a high standard of living within the cities that they have today. New York City, every building is a different height. Every floor has different moldings, different windows and everything. So if you design like that, that might be great for the free enterprise system to continuously sell things. But it's not good for a resource-based economy where you want to house, feed, clothe everybody on Earth. You think of architecture very differently. So a lot of things are interchangeable. A lot of things are changeable, so you can, like if you had an automobile, you do a couple handles, pull out the engine, put in another engine, and you take off. Same thing with televisions and electronics. You just plug in a different one, and when it's updated, you take out the old one.
But how do we recycle that?
Everything would be recycled and considered to be recycled. And they're beginning to do that today with the Infi Cradle to Cradle. And it's not just recycled, so you can use it a couple times and then go to the dump and then it would pollute. You have to think about it converting into something else. Yeah. So this is recreation. And in here, you own nothing, but you have access to everything. And the whole idea within a resource-based economy is create abundance as quickly as possible. Because when there is scarcity, that's when you have trouble. You know, on the islands, when Jacques went there, there was no scarcity, so they shared with everybody. But the interesting thing about that was when the kids were a certain age, sometimes they put a lot of kids on the boats, kind of like a kayak, I forget what it, outrigger canoe, and they'd point to the sea, and they'd have to go find their own island. So the island never, the carrying capacity never exceeded, you know, the population never exceeded the carrying capacity. So they would share with everybody. But if they had a shortage, then they'd end up putting it behind a banana and say, no, I don't have any bananas. You know what I mean? It creates a different dynamic in your behavior. So, when people are much more amiable when they have things and they can share things. But it's not so much sharing, it's having access and making an abundance, because sharing has bad connotations today. It's like you're giving up something, but it's not that at all. So you go to the, if you play golf, we don't play golf. to us, it's like going all through evolution, then you have a guy with a stick putting a ball in a hole. Is that what we went all through
evolution for?
Yeah. So, and then it's not, life is not hard enough. You just set up trouble along the way to get it in that hole. But anyway, it's ridiculous to us. But people play golf, so they would go to the clubhouse, they would check out the very best clubs, use them, bring them back, they're kept in tee shape. So you don't want, if you have a stockholder kind of in all the Earth's resources, everybody owns all the Earth's resources, why would you make something that wears out and breaks down? Mm-hmm. It's good today because you have to continuously sell and make things and sell to keep this system going. But so consequently, we're plundering the earth for this system, the monetary system. So here's indoor agriculture, outdoor agriculture. We think in the future most people would want to live in high rises. It's like a total enclosure system. You have hobby shops, you have music, you have art centers, music centers, you have education, medicals in here as well. But we do show houses because people, that's where they're at today. This is your art center, music center, entertainment center in here, and some recreation, like tennis courts. But these are your research centers, and everything that they're researching there goes to improve your standard of living. There's no stockholders, there's no stockbrokers, no bankers, no insurance people, no advertisers, you know, nothing that's manipulating money or a vulture over you, you know. Like if you get a toothache, somebody makes a couple thousand bucks off you. If you bump your car, somebody makes another few thousand bucks off you. None of that in the future. These are your access centers where you can go in and check out anything you like. And in the middle might be the brains and the guts of the system or your medical care. This is just conceptual and it would be made differently. Each one is different because of the needs of the city, whatever it's working on. And your energy systems are on the outside. Your roadways are black and generate electricity as well. So do your rooftops or your baby gardens and grow food is also. So we'll go on quickly if you have time to another building.
One question, how much the city can hold people?
It would vary, it would totally vary. You know, if you had, this might be 300,000 and then the agricultural belt might be a little wider, you know.
Yeah, you can.
But you wouldn't so much expand. You'd make everything go back to nature, and then you'd build another city. Mm. And you'd have mass transportation, a monorail going from one city to the other. All clean transportation, no cars in there. Right. We're going to another building. We'll go to the left. Jack also worked for special effects in Hollywood. And he designed, Jacques designed speedboats that won races all over the world. He designed the car. He designed the first aluminum house after World War II. I'm just going to do something in here. I'm just going to put on the.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, how are we doing? 315.
Yes,
yeah,
you really pressed for time. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, well, there's another whole building. You want to just walk into this other building and go back, or no? You need to go back now?
Let's go.
Let's just peek.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this kind of just grew as we had the next job because we didn't take out any mortgages.
Do you see this curved screen, Diane?
Yes. Yep.
The effects of the curved screen.
Ботанikos sodą.
Tačiau klimatas geras.
Jo, jo, subtropinis.
Tau galiu pažiūrėti.
Aš jau negaliu laikyti viskas.
Oh!
Congratulations,
come and they defecate, you know, and they eat the oranges,
right?
And then they defecate.
Mm-hmm. They're the same.
Oyster grows. Mm-hmm. But just briefly, Jack doesn't just do domes, you know, he has all sorts of different buildings, but they're all curved and they're round because it's extremely strong. What we usually do in the tours, we have one piece of paper and we scotch tape it and then we pile books on it. Usually about 40 books or 50 books, just to show people how strong the round structure is, why Jacques builds round, but we won't have time to do that. These are cities in the sea to clean up the oceans for energy, food, pharmaceuticals, and the military dumped 67 tons of nerve gas and steel canisters off the coast of Florida in the Gulf Stream in 1971, and you have to clean up all that stuff. You know,
which do you really ever clean it all up?
Yeah.
That's my question.
Yeah, well, you have to approach it. So anyway, if Jacques was just an architect, he'd be prolific. And this is an invention where Jacques extrudes buildings, and you cut them.
Yeah.
And then you move them on site, and you plug them in. That's how you feed, I mean, that's how you house people quickly. Not like Jimmy Carter, he might be a nice guy, but that's a feel-good organization. It doesn't house the poor. When you beg for nickels and dimes and have people with hammers.
Has anything ever happened with this?
No.
No,
and why not?
It will. They eventually, John talked about a lot of different technology, and they have applied the technology he has talked about for over 60 years, 70 years, because they eventually come to it, but the most important thing is a social idea. He's not interested in just designing houses, because he did design houses. After World War II, he did a beautiful house that he had investors for, that they liked it so much they showed it at Warner Brothers Studios. The head of the studio showed it there. It was a house that was 8 men, 10 hours. It went together very quickly. It was very low cost. It was great. And it got squelched politically. Mm-hmm. He wanted the veterans to have low cost housing. And the head of the Veterans Association came by and said, I want a piece of it. And the backers were idealists, and they said, well, if we give you a piece of it, we can't give it to the low cost to the veterans. And he said, you won't get this.